Hello everyone, this is Dr. Tushar Mehta. I'm an orthopedic surgeon, your faculty of orthopedics. Today this video is about a very quick revision for your NEET PG exams. The first topic, I'm sure you all can see on the screen right now that what we are talking about is rotator cuffs. Even we talk about rotator cuff, what are the important MCQs about rotator cuff? The first MCQ is this, that rotator cuff is made up of number one, subscapularis, number two, supraspinatus, number three, infraspinatus, number four, teres minor. The most interesting thing that this rotator cuff is present superiorly, is present anteriorly, is present posteriorly, but that is deficient. Come on, speak up everyone. Inferiorly. So a very old MCQ which used to come a lot of times, that rotator cuff is constituted by all of the following tendons except, and there used to be two options, teres minor, teres major. Normally people get confused, but don't get confused. Remember, rotator cuff is a major topic, but the muscle inside the rotator cuff is not major, it is minor, teres minor. Of course, a very common question which is asked often, that which is the most common joint to undergo dislocation? Answer is shoulder. Which is the most common joint to undergo recurrent dislocation? Answer is again shoulder. Now, can you tell me what are the causes behind recurrent shoulder dislocation? The first cause, the most common cause that we all need to know, is what is called as Bankart lesion. Now, when I talk about Bankart lesion, what do you mean by Bankart lesion? Bankart lesion is basically avulsion of glenoid labrum. But that is not important. What is important is that it is avulsion of glenoid labrum in which part? It is an avulsion of glenoid labrum in anteroinferior part, and that is why some of the people, they make this mnemonic, that is what is called as BIG. When I say BIG, Bankart anteroinferior glenoid labrum. So since we have mentioned the first cause, we need to mention the second cause, which is relatively the less common cause. So the second cause, which is relatively less common cause, is called as Hill-Sack lesion. It is a bony defect where in the head of humerus, where in the posterolateral aspect of head of humerus, that is called Hill-Sack lesion. When I was preparing, like, you used to remember it like this: H for Hill-Sack, H for head, H for humerus, and there is a defect in PL, posterolateral aspect, so HHPL. Moving over to the next question, this is one important image-based question that keeps coming often. I'm sure you all can see that a baby is made to lie down supine on the examination couch with hips and knees as flexed as possible. Then you have to stand in front of the baby and you have to compare the level of two knee joints together. If you see level of this knee joint, and then if you see level of this knee joint, then definitely this knee joint is at a lower level. When I say that it is at a lower level, then definitely that means that this limb has something which is called as shortening. But you know what, in an entrance exam, when you're sitting on a chair in front of a computer screen, you have a lot of your life at stake, and it is at that point of time that they will not even ask you the details of the test. They will just ask you the name of the test. So the name of the test is what is called as Galeazzi test. Absolutely, it is that same Galeazzi as that of Galeazzi's fracture. So this is called as Galeazzi's test, also what is called as Allis sign. When we talk about this kind of an x-ray, I'm sure you can see everything is absolutely normal, but I'm sure you can see some fissures, some cracks, some fragmentation, some cystic areas. So what are we talking about in this particular scenario? We are talking about Perthes disease. I totally expect a long stem clinical question to come in your exam for Perthes disease, in which you will have a boy, you will have a 7-year-old boy, you will have a painful hip. Not only that, but you will have a limping gait as well. But apart from that, two very important things will be mentioned in that question, that there will be difficulty in squatting. Not only there will be difficulty in squatting, but there will be difficulty in cross-legged sitting. Maybe you can expect a question on this, that what is the investigation of choice? Answer will be MRI. That's what maximum you can expect. Alright, now moving over to the next question. In this question, a very important frame of an image based question on your screens right now. On the right hand side, what you see and what you can see is what is called as a very important radiological line, called as Klein's line, which I'm sure you all can see. It is drawn along the superior surface of neck of femur, and normally it will always see dissecting a part of the head of the femur. But there is a disease called as slipped capital femoral epiphysis, in which when we draw the same line, do you see that intersecting the head of the femur? The answer is no, and it is at this point of time this Klein's line becomes Trithoven sign. So on the right hand side you have a normal radiological line, on the left hand side you have an abnormal radiological sign. By the way, Trithoven sign, SCFE. Now when we talk about SCFE, the first thing that will be mentioned, if at all a long stem clinical question comes on SCFE, the first thing which will be mentioned will be, it will be a boy. It will be somewhere close to puberty. So when I say close to puberty, they will mention probably 14 years approximately. They will mention a lot of endocrinological issue. That can be hypothyroidism, hypogonadism, excess growth hormone, I don't know anything. The boy will excessively obese, and it will be, of course, the weight for age will be high. And then of course there will be pain in the hip, and there will be limping gait, and you know, the technicalities remain the same. And they might ask you the diagnosis, or they might ask you the finding of the x-ray, which you will say, of course, Trithoven sign, or they will ask you investigation of choice, which is very simple, MRI. Do not expect any question on the treatment. When we talk about clinical tests, please try to understand, in your entrance exam either you will have an image or you will have a video, either you will have a chitra or you will have a chal chitra. They will never ask you to perform the test. So at this moment, in the last moment, it is our job to absorb the images of these tests. So if a patient is lying down prone with knee in 90 degree flexion, with foot in external rotation, with knee 90 degree flexion, and if the person, if the doctor examines a downward push, we call it Apley's grinding test. The only, I repeat everyone, the only clinical test for any basic ligament injury of the knee where the patient is prone. So this is Apley's grinding test, not much followed because you're not supposed to grind the ligament. So what we follow is basically what is called as McPerry's test, in which your hand has to hold the knee, your other hand has to hold the foot, you have to rotate the foot internally, then straighten the knee, you have to rotate the foot externally and then straighten the knee. This is the gist that one needs to absorb about Apley's and McPerry's test. Well, if you really want to check the medial collateral ligament, take the leg away from midline, which is what is called as valgus. So please try to understand that valgus stress test will be for MCL tear. If you want to check the ligament on the lateral side, which is lateral collateral ligament, then you have to take the leg towards the midline. So that is what is called as varus stress test. I hope you got it right. As far as these two ligaments are concerned, I'm sure everybody knows that this is ACL, this is PCL. See, please try to understand that when we talk about ACL and PCL, always remember this basic anatomy that both are within the joint. Always remember that basic anatomy that both are within the confines of the capsule. Always remember this basic anatomy that despite being within the joint, despite being within the capsule, they are not completely reflected, covered or bathed by synovium. Both have a same blood supply, that is called as middle geniculate artery. Both have a common nerve supply, that is what is called as posterior articular nerve. If you really want to understand the basic anatomy, this, believe me, is very, very important. Apart from this, what you need to know is this, that ACL is important whenever we plan to go downhill. PCL is important whenever we plan to go uphill. This is again a very basic difference that I feel that everybody should know. Alright, now coming back to their test, I'm sure you all can see that if your knee is in 90 degree flexion, if the doctor is sitting on the dorsum of the foot holding the proximal tibia in such a way that two thumbs are onto the tibial tuberosity while fingers are embracing the posterior part of the leg, and if the doctor pulls it towards himself, that is what is called as anterior drawer test. If the doctor pushes it back, that is what is called as posterior drawer test, as the name of the test suggests, anterior drawer test. Problem is this 90 degree flexion, because this is a very painful condition. If you want, you can do it on yourself. You will not be very happy. If your knee is injured, you will not be very happy in taking your knee to 90 degree flexion. So if you are performing some other test which is done in 30 degrees of flexion, where again you are pulling tibia towards yourself but stabilizing femur with the other hand, then that is what is called as Latchman test, and believe me, it is considered to be the test of choice for acute ACL tear. When we talk about this very, very interesting and important topic, just tell me, what do you think I'm talking about? I'm talking about osteoarthritis. What is the first X-ray sign of osteoarthritis that one can see? Is reduction of the joint space? Is that symmetrical or asymmetrical? Asymmetrical, where medial reduction occurs earlier and more as compared to lateral reduction. Reason is pretty simple, because weight-bearing axis of the body does not pass from midline of the knee, it passes slightly middle to midline. So technically, if you can see the fibula, then this is the lateral compartment, this is the medial compartment. So you can see that here joint space is quite less as compared to this one. Now, when we talk about fractures of the spine, now please try to understand that if you see a fracture of ring of C1, which is atlas, then people are going to call it as Jefferson's fracture. If you see a fracture of the pedicle of C2, that means axis. By the way, C1 is atlas, C2 is axis. So if you are going to see something like this in an image-based question, then of course you should mark the answer as Hangman's fracture. But if you see something like this, which is a horizontal fracture line running across all three columns of spine, then we are going to call this condition as, please believe me when I tell you, chance fracture, also what is called as seatbelt injury. If you see an avulsion fracture of tip of spinous process of C7, I'm sure this is something which you all have revised by now. This is what is called as Clay-Schauvillers fracture. So in spine, four very routinely asked fracture, C1 ring is Jefferson, C2 pedicle is Hangman. This kind of fracture, chance fracture, C7 spinous process tip, Clay-Schauvillers fracture. By the way, again, a very important MCQ, not only from orthopedics, but from the aspect of radiology, physiology as well. Last reflex to disappear, okay, and simultaneously first reflex to reappear in a patient of spinal shock, or what do you call as neurogenic shock? The answer is very simple for all of us, that is bulbocavernosus reflex or bulbospongiosus reflex. I hope it makes sense to you. When we talk about another very important MCQ, I'm sure by now we all have understood that when we talk about Klippel-Feil syndrome, please try to understand that you have a triad. In the triad, you have a short webbed neck, which I don't think I need to show it to you. I'm sure you all can see that you have decreased mobility at neck, which I'm sure you can very well imagine. The third thing which I want you to understand in the triad is low posterior hairline, which I'm sure you can see this. Now, coming straight to the MCQ, see, triad itself is not a great MCQ. What is a great MCQ is that short stature. I know most of you are smiling right now because all of you knew this, that short stature is an integral component of the disease called Klippel-Feil syndrome, but not a part of the triad. The most common association of this topic is something which I'm sure you all can see in this image, is lateral tilting of the spine. That is what is called as scoliosis. Alright, so most common association, scoliosis. Now, since talking about scoliosis, if at all an image-based question on angles in orthopedics comes, then most of the chance the thing is this angle, what is called as Cobb's angle. So how do you calculate Cobb's angle? Nobody will ever ask you. What is the interpretation of Cobb's angle? Nobody will ever ask you. They will give you an image or an x-ray in which they will show some lateral bending of the spine, and they will make a few lines, and they will ask you to identify the angle. It's just that they would not mention Cobb's angle. They will ask you, what is the angle? Answer will be Cobb's angle. Well, I'm sure everybody knows that Saturday night palsy is basically a postural nerve palsy, is basically a positional nerve palsy, and according to the Seddon's classification of peripheral nerve injury, it falls under the category, I'm sure you all can tell me, it falls under the category of neurapraxia. And believe me when I tell you that most of the times, even I've seen this as a question, that Saturday night palsy falls under the category of your answer should be neurapraxia. The treatment for this kind of a condition is never, ever, 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 ever wait and watch. It is not wait and watch, it is dynamic walk-up sprint. Please get this into your head. Well, I'm sure you all have understood that we are talking about something which is called as cubitus varus. In fact, the slide has a gun along with it, so you will be able to identify. We are talking about gun stock deformity. How does this develop? That most common complication of supracondylar fracture humerus is malunion, which in turn leads to cubitus varus. Well, if you talk about supracondylar fracture humerus, you know, we cannot consider it to be complete unless and until we do not talk about most common nerve injury and we do not talk about most common arterial injury. As far as most common arterial injury is concerned, I would like to mention here in front of all of you, answer will be brachial artery. Reason is very simple. There is only one artery in this area. Most common nerve injury is anterior introitus nerve, which is a motor branch of median nerve, and you should remember this. When we talk about supracondylar fracture humerus and we do not talk about its complication called as compartment syndrome, I think that is simply not justified. It's not fair. And when we talk about compartment syndrome, then essentially we should know these few MCQs, that which is the first symptom of compartment syndrome, answer is essentially pain. Which is the first sign of compartment syndrome? Answer is essentially pain on passive stretching of the finger, which is basically what is called as, I'm sure everybody knows by now, stretch test. Another very basic MCQ that comes is, which is the most unreliable feature of compartment syndrome? Answer is pulselessness. You cannot believe on it whether it is presence or absence is going to make 100% difference. Which is the last, you know, P to develop in compartment syndrome? Answer is not pulselessness, it is paralysis. Another MCQ, that out of all these, whatever we have discussed, which is the most specific hallmark characteristic diagnostic P? Answer is, of course, stretch test. I hope I make some sense to you in this very frequently asked topic for MCQs. Moving further, talking about supracondylar fracture humerus, if we do not talk about this ectopic bone, benign bone, abnormal bone, pathological bone, then it does not make any difference. So please try to understand that this ectopic, benign, abnormal, pathological bone is actually formed in a muscle, leading to inflammation of a muscle. Now, what do you mean by muscle? Myoinflammation, itis formation of bone, that is simply myositis ossificans, which is of course a delayed complication and a rare complication, but still it happens in supracondylar fracture humerus, which will happen only and only if you will do a passive massage or a passive manipulation after healing of a fracture. Please don't do that. If at all any clinical stem MCQ has to come, it will come from this. Many times they will not ask you about the fracture, they won't ask you about the classification, they won't ask you about any complication. They will simply ask you, what do you see? You will say, sir, I see something which is called as tension band wiring. Where else do you see, sir? I see this not only in fracture olecranon, I see this in fracture patella as well. Simple. Moving further, if you see a fracture, which image-based question is very, you know, frequently asked. So let me show you that image-based question. So this image-based question is something which was very, you know, important at one point of time. So if you see a fracture of proximal one-third of ulnar shaft, and not only that, if you see radial head dislocation, then obviously we are talking about a very important fracture called as Montijo fracture. If you want to understand the other one, which is Galeazzi or reverse Montijo or Piedmont, please try to understand that you have a fracture of shaft of radius. Now, this fracture of shaft of radius is classically at the junction of middle and distal 1/3, which I'm sure you all can see. Not only this, but you see distal radio ulnar joint dislocation as well. So combining this together, you know, when you combine this together, you will end up into a Galeazzi fracture or a reverse Montegia fracture. If you see just a isolated fracture of shaft of ulna, that is what is called as nightstick fracture. If you can see, this is definitely an oblique fracture. This is definitely a fracture of shaft of humerus. Particularly, if you see, it is at the junction of upper 2/3 and lower 1/3, and of course it is the place from where the radial nerve is coming from, posterior to anterior. So, but obviously that this area will have radial nerve injury, and this fracture is a very frequently asked fracture in your entrance exam. That is what is called as Holston-Lewy fracture. Now, moving further to our next fracture, if you can see, then this is radius, this is scaphoid. So technically you have a radioscaphoid joint subluxation, and not only you have a radioscaphoid joint subluxation, but you have an intra-articular fracture of the distal end of the radius going inside the wrist joint. By the way, this fracture is what is called as, come on, speak up everyone, this fracture is called as Barton's fracture. Now, when we talk about Barton's fracture, we have to talk about Schoffer's fracture. Now, this is scaphoid, this is radius. First of all, please try to understand that radioscaphoid joint anatomy is absolutely intact, absolutely normal. But in the previous fracture that was dislocated, here it is absolutely intact. And if you see this, this is an intra-articular fracture of the distal end of radius, but that's not important. That was the case with the previous fracture also. Then what is the difference? The difference is very simple, that here you see a very discrete segment, and that discrete segment is what is called as radial styloid segment. So what you can see here is a discrete fracture segment, and that discrete fracture segment is basically fracture of the radial styloid, which makes the entire difference. Alright, fracture of the distal end of radius with radial styloid fracture. Alright, so this is how you see this particular fracture here. Alright, now if you see the next fracture, Olise and Smith. Well, just one thing what we need to remember is that both are extra-articular fractures, but of course both are extra-articular fracture of the distal end of the radius. But then what is important to be remembered by all of us, if there is a dorsal displacement of distal fragment, we are going to call it as Colles. But if there is a volar, I'm sure you all can see, if there is a volar displacement of distal fragment, then we are going to call this fracture as Smith's fracture. All right. Moving further with our revision of the fractures, well, if they talk about tenderness at anatomical snuff box, if they talk about fall on outstretched hand, if they talk about a young adult male, obviously answer has to be fracture of the scaphoid. Not only this, there are a few more MCQs that one should know is this, that what is the most common complication of fracture scaphoid? It is not irascular necrosis, it is non-union. Then they can ask you which is the most common site of fracture. Answer has to be waist. They can ask you any particular x-ray view that you find is crucial for understanding this is basically oblique view. Now, if you are aware of these fractures, then the next step is that you should be aware of this very important clinical condition, where you will find a young boy, you will find him into excessive running, either by choice or by pressure. You will find some sort of a tenderness at the knee. When you will find all these things, you will see formation of a bony spur at insertion of ligamentum patelli onto the tibial tuberosity. And when we talk about such kind of a condition, then this is what is called as Osgood-Schlatter's disease. a very, very important orthopedic radiology topic. You will find all these conditions mentioned over there. Well, if you see something called as diaphyseal, if you see something called as diaphyseal fractures, if you see something which is called as different stages of healing, I mean, there are fractures, but they are in different stages of healing. And if you see something like this, which is called as deformities, then please try to remember that these three D's take you towards the diagnosis of osteogenesis imperfecta. So in this osteogenesis imperfecta, please try to understand that there is a type 1 collagen synthesis defect. And not only, you know, they will mention in a long stem clinical MCQ, they will mention about all these things. They will mention about dental issues as well, which will include delayed dentition and poor dentition. Then they will show you something which is what is called as an endobone sign, which is called as bone within a bone sign. Not only this, but they will show you something which is called as Erlenmeyer flask deformity. So all these things will automatically take you towards the diagnosis of something called as osteopetrosis, also called as marble bone disease, which will clinically they will mention the things exactly same as that of bone marrow suppression or bone marrow failure. All right, now the next very important and very frequently asked image based MCQ, whether it is orthopedics and radiology, is river jersey spine, where we talk about not only osteopetrosis, but we also talk about a condition called as renal osteodystrophy. So river jersey spine is seen in both of them. If the entrance exam is of a pattern where more than one option is correct, you can mark both, but if you have to choose one, always remember R for river jersey is more classical of R for ROD. Well, this x-ray sign, I'm sure you all can see, it is the conical shape, translucency with a narrow apex and broad base, is what is called as flame sign, also called as, you can see the flame, also called as blade of grass sign. Just that you need to tell me which condition do you see this. It is a very, very important, again, overlapping topic between orthopedics and radiology. It is seen in Paget's disease. Very interesting thing, the name of the sign uses the word osteoporosis, but it is not seen in osteoporosis. So this well circumscribed, all right, so this well circumscribed patch of osteopenia, what you can see here is called as osteoporosis circumscripta, again something which is seen in Paget's disease of the bone. If you see this, I'm sure you can see these white fluffy exudates, and again they resemble as if, you know, some cotton wool is there, and of course they will also be seen in Paget's disease of the bone without any confusion. Now, if R for river jersey spine was more classical of R for renal osteodystrophy, please try to understand that P for pitcher frame spine is more classical of P for Paget's disease of the bone. Basically, what I want you to understand is this, that if the superior end plate is dense white, if the inferior end plate is dense or white, we can call it river jersey spine. But if all four, anterior, posterior, superior, inferior, are dense and white, we call it pitcher frame spine. What you are looking at right now is basically called as fish mouth spine, and this fish mouth spine is what is called as biconcave vertebra. That is also what is called as cord fish spine. Why do I say it's a biconcave vertebra? I'm sure you all can see that superior end plate is concave, inferior end plate is concave. It is seen in two conditions, osteomalacia, osteoporosis. If you have to choose one, please remember what I have told you. R for river jersey is more classical of R for renal osteodystrophy. P for pitcher frame is more classical of P for Paget's. Then please remember M for mouth is more classical of M for malacia. Very frequently asked question, loser zone is what you can see right now, which is a classical x-ray hallmark of osteomalacia. And of course you should know about loser zone. By the way, loser, why the name word loser? The doctor was loser. I mean, the person who gave this, his name was Emil Loser, nobody else was loser. So he described this pseudo fracture. Loser zone is also known by the name of pseudo fractures. Why? Because they look like fractures, but in true sense they are not. Whenever there is an osteoporosis due to the collapse compression fracture of osteoporosis, it leads to a reduction of the vertebral body height, which is basically nothing but due to the pathological fracture. So if there is a question that most common cause of pathological fracture in our human body, overall answer is osteoporosis. If they ask you most common complication of osteoporosis, then your answer has to be, of course, pathological fracture. But if they ask you what is the most common site of pathological fracture, then you have to say vertebral body, lower thoracic spine, primarily T12. Fishbone, we have already discussed. For osteoporosis, there is only one investigation of choice, which is called as Texas scan. Let me say the full form, dual energy X-ray absorptiometry, which is the investigation of choice, which is the gold standard investigation for this condition called as osteoporosis. When we talk about interpretation of T-score, please remember, if it is 0 to minus 1, if it is 0 to minus 1, we consider it to be normal. If it is minus 1 to minus 2.5, we consider it to be osteopenia. If it is less than minus 2.5, we consider it to be osteoporosis. Alright, now when we talk about T-score, a woman is women to match to women, Asian woman is matched to Asian women, but there is a hypothetical theoretical score where not only a woman will be matched to a woman, an Asian woman will be matched to an Asian woman, but a 60-year-old Asian woman will be matched to a 60-year-old Asian woman. So if you're keeping sex and race constant, T-score, if you're keeping all the three constant, Z-score. This central piece of bone will always be called as sequestrum, which is a dead, ischemic, necrotic, unhealthy, non-viable, non-vital piece of bone, which is surrounded by this reactive, immature, subperiosteal, healthy new bone, which is called as involucrum, which has got certain holes in it. That is what is called as cloaca in the singular and cloacae in the plural. Again, I would like to show you sequestrum all around involucrum, small, small holes, cloacae. Sequestrum, involucrum, holes, cloacae. If you see something here in the proximal tibia, if you see something in the metaphyseal area, then obviously we are talking about a subacute form of osteomyelitis, which is essentially surgically treated. I'm sure you have understood that we are talking about a variant of osteomyelitis called Brodie's abscess. But if you are talking about a 10-year-old child, if you are talking about involvement of mandible, if you are talking about some onion skin or onion peel appearance, and if you are talking about a non-suppurative long-standing chronic condition, then I'm sure you all can understand that we are talking about another variant of osteomyelitis, which is basically Gary's osteomyelitis. As far as this topic is concerned, just remember the mnemonic, that is called as CAVE, where C stands for cavus, A stands for adduction, V stands for inversion, where adduction plus inversion is combined together to be called as varus, E basically stands for equinus. By the way, the question says the first deformity to be corrected, answer is cavus. The last deformity to be corrected, the answer is equinus. The most difficult deformity to be corrected, answer is equinus. The most common to reoccur, answer is again equinus. When we talk about CTEV shoes, remember three facts. They should not have a heel to basically prevent equinus. They should have a straight inner border. Why? To prevent, because if there is a straight inner border, they can prevent adduction. They should have a outer shoe race to basically prevent inversion. You can very well imagine, straight heel means there won't be equinus, inner border straight, no heel means no equinus, inner border straight means no adduction, outer shoe race means the foot will be in eversion, not in inversion. Now, the five steps of fracture healing in terms of their duration are very, very important. The first step, hematoma formation within 1 week. The second step is inflammation, which can happen up to 2 to 3 weeks. The third step is chondrogenesis, also what is called as, you know, chondrogenesis, also what is called as soft callus, which is formed at 3rd week. It is the first visible X-ray sign of fracture union. The next one is woven bone, which is hard callus, which is seen at 4 to 6 weeks, which is the first clinical sign of fracture union. All right. And the last step, remodeling done by osteoclast in 2 to 3 years. So we have already discussed first X-ray sign, soft callus, first clinical sign, woven bone. Now two important MCQs: fractured distal 1/3 of tibia is not surrounded by significant soft tissue, therefore is the most common to go into non-union. And most common reason behind non-union is when patient is not inadequately, the patient is inadequately immobilized. When you see this, I'm sure there is no confusion to anybody that you see a growth of the bone coming outside the bone, growing away from the joint. Most common benign bone tumor, not a true bone tumor, seen in metaphysis of distal femur. I'm talking about osteochondroma. I'm sure you can see a central radiolucent nidus, which is having diameter of less than 2 centimeters. Humongously rich in prostaglandins. I am talking about a very important condition called as osteoid. Since there are prostaglandins, that is the reason why in this condition you will see night pain, and that is why in this condition you will see aspirin relief. So if you hear these kind of words, then automatically your diagnosis goes towards osteoid osteoma. Now when we talk about sun ray or sunburst appearance, everybody knows that this is basically nothing but periosteal reaction, which is along the Sharpe's fiber. Now this periosteal reaction along the Sharpe's fiber, which is sun ray or sunburst appearance, if you combine it with this periosteal elevation, I'm sure you all can tell me that this periosteal elevation is the reason behind a very important radiology MCQ called as Codman's triangle. So whether we talk about sun ray or we talk about Codman's triangle, I'm talking about osteosarcoma. Again, a very frequently asked question. So if your patient shows an expansile lytic lesion, and if the patient is skeletally mature, if epiphyseal metaphyseal area is involved, if distal femur is involved, and if you see something like soap bubble appearance, then obviously your answer goes in the favor of giant cell tumor, also called as osteoclastoma. I'm sure you can see the growth plate. So if your patient is skeletally immature, if the location of the condition is in metaphysis, if you see basically proximal tibia involved, and if you see multiple blood filled sinusoids, you know, with septae in between, then everything goes in the favor of ABC. Then everything will go in the favor of ABC. Now if you see involvement of a phalanx, or if you see involvement of a metacarpal, and if you see a geographical destruction, a well-defined geographical destruction, then obviously your answer has to go in the favor of enchondroma. So now there are a few clinical tests that one needs to understand, rather than understanding, as I said initially also, that you just need to absorb the gist of the test. So what you are can see here is basically called as Adson's test. What you can see here is basically what is called as Phalen's test. What you can see here is what is called as Durkin's test. By the way, this Adson's test is something which is done for cervical rib, also called as thoracic outlet syndrome. If you see Phalen's test, it is done for carpal tunnel syndrome, which is basically compression of median nerve. If you see Durkin's test, which is again for carpal tunnel syndrome, that is compression of median nerve, but you need to understand that it is considered to be the most specific test for diagnosis of carpal tunnel syndrome. Now simultaneously you should look for something which is called as Tinel sign, which is again for carpal tunnel syndrome, which is basically meant for median nerve. Now if you see, then this is what is called as Penn test, which is for abductor pollicis brevis, which is again meant for median nerve. Okay, now if you see this, then this is what is called as Book test, also what is called as Frohman sign, which is basically for ulnar nerve, also what is called as adductor pollicis. Alright, so basically this is for the adductor pollicis, book test or Froment sign, adduction of the finger. Now what you can see here is basically the weak OK sign. Alright, weak OK sign, also called as Kilohonewin sign, which is seen in anterior introsseous nerve palsy. Alright, now if you see this, then this is basically card test, which is for palmar introsseae. By the way, nerve supply is ulnar nerve. What you can see here is basically Egawa's test, which is for the dorsal introsseae. The nerve supply is ulnar nerve. This is checking adduction of the fingers. This is checking abduction of the fingers. Now if you see this, again a very frequently asked question, it is basically Thomas test, which is done for flexion deformity. It is done for flexion deformity at the level of hip joint. If you see, this is what is called as Ober. It's not Ober, it is Ober's test. Ober's test, which is basically for iliotibial band contracture or tightness. Now, few image-based questions. Thomas splint, you can identify just by this. Nobody will ever ask you a question on detail on this. Just identify the image. Answer is Thomas splint. Identify this image. Come on, identify this image. That is basically Bohler-Braun splint. Now, what you identify in this image is basically aeroplane splint. Now, what is this? Identify the image. Come on, everyone. Gallows traction. All right. Now, identify this. This is basically called as handshake cast for Cooley's fracture. This is called as glass holding cast for fracture scaphoid. Identification is very simple. If thumb is free, Cooley's fracture. If thumb is covered, glass holding cast. Now this is what you call a cylinder cast or tube cast. Cylinder cast or tube cast, which is essentially meant for fracture patella, which starts just above the middle of the thigh and finishes just above the malleoli. Ankle is absolutely kept free, which is not the case in other conditions. Now what you can see here, you know, what you can see here is basically called as Steenman's pin, which is the most common implant for application of skeletal traction. What you can see here is called as Denham's pin, and the identification is the central grooves is the identification feature. Both are used for skeletal traction. Overall, most common Steenman pin and cancellous bone like calcaneum, Denham pin. What you can see here is called as K-wire. If you want to know the full name, it is called as Kirschner's wire. What you want to talk about here is what is called as Bohler's stirrup. Use Steenman, Denham, K-wire. At the end of the day, everything is to be connected with Bohler's stirrup. This is basically the classical identification feature. It is the clover leaf shaped cross section, and this is basically nothing but what is called as K nail or Kuncher's nail. I have already shown it to you. I hope you remember when we were talking about fracture of the olecranon, I had shown it to you. So this is tension band wiring, not used only for olecranon but for patella, and believe me, for the last couple of years it has become important. So just look at this image, a very frequently asked image, knuckle bender splint for ulnar nerve palsy oblique claw hand, cock up splint for radial nerve palsy wrist drop. This is AFO, ankle foot orthosis for common peroneal nerve palsy foot drop. When we talk about bone cutter, you will see sharp cutting edges of the instrument. Bone nibbler will have basically hollow edges, because cutter is to cut the bone, nibbler is to grab the bone and pull it out. So nibbler will always have hollow edges, cutter will always have sharp edges. If one edge is serrated and the other edge is smooth, it has to be a plate holding forceps. All right, if both the edges are serrated, then it has to be a bone holding forceps. So one is serrated, one is smooth, plate holding. This is serrated, this is also serrated, bone holding. This is what you are looking at right now. This is what you are looking at right now is called as Homan's bone liver. What you are looking at right now is called as Bristow's bone liver. This is what you are looking at right now is called as periosteal elevator. All right, again, a very frequently asked question. Again, tension band wiring, as I said multiple times, it is a very, very important question. A quick recap, this is called as PTB cast. Full form patellar tendon bearing cast, basically used for fracture of the shaft of the tibia. By the way, this is for fracture patella. This is called as below knee cast. This is called as above knee cast, can be used for other conditions. Now, I'm sure you all can see that this is called as genu verum or bow legs. This is basically called as genu valgus or knock knees. This is called as wind swept deformity. What does that mean? Genu varus in one knee. I'm sure you can see genu valgus on another knee. Well, metaphyseal cupping, splaying, fraying, everything along with rosary is taking you towards the diagnosis of rickets. Please try to understand, if your BIP is normal and your DIP is in flexion, if your BIP is normal and DIP is in flexion, then that condition is called as mallet finger. If your PIP is in hyperextension and your DIP is in flexion like the previous condition, then it is what is called as Swan neck deformity or finger. If you just do the opposite, that means you take PIP into flexion and you take DIP into hyperextension, then this is what is called as, you know, you call it bautuna here, you call it buttonhole or whatever you want to call it. As far as the blood supply of a meniscus is concerned, always remember one thing, that it is from periphery to center. When I say periphery to center, what does that mean? That outer one third, that's why it's called as a red zone, because it has more blood supply. Middle one third is called as red white zone, it has less blood supply. Inner one third is called as white white zone, since there is no blood supply. Well, we have already covered it. So, in this defined period of time, I wanted to revise as much as I can, so that if at all anybody out of you is still pending with the revision of orthopedics, all you can do is, after you are done with the day, you can just watch this video. Believe me, if you have come till this point, that means you have captured almost every probable MCQ which is going to be asked. Agar aap yahan tak aa gaye hain dosto, to aap har MCQ khatam kar chuke hain is waqt jo aapke exam ke andar aane wala hai. Bas ek hi cheez chahiye. Show up, don't give up, keep yourself cool. I wish you all the best. God bless to all of you. Manage your time, manage your skill, manage your mind, manage your life. I wish you all the best.